Our Bible reading today is from chapter 11 of the letter to the Hebrews. In the first part of this chapter, the writer has been talking about the faith of some of the Old Testament saints, like Noah, Abraham and Moses. Now he explains that there were many, many more people who were commended for their faith in God. Hebrews chapter 11, starting at verse 32. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson and Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. There were others who were tortured, refusing to be released, so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging, and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawn in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and ill-treated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, hello. It's great to be with you again. Delighted to be here in St. Nick's. Great to be preaching in the church. And fantastic to bring God's word to you on All Saints' Day. All Saints' Day should be one of the brightest and most exciting days in the church calendar. Sadly, we have to say, it's become horribly overshadowed by Halloween and by all the scary, ghoulish images that go with that. But this is a day of celebration, and I want to convince you of that as we open God's word together. This is our day to celebrate the women and men of faith who've gone before us, the great cloud of witnesses, unnumbered folk who've walked with God. The church that received this letter to the Hebrews had become discouraged. And the writer specifically uses this passage in order to give them encouragement. And do you know what? We need encouragement, don't we? This isn't the easiest time we've been through in our lives. We need encouragement. So bring it on. Let's hear what the Word of God has to say to us. There's that line in the Apostles' Creed. I don't know if you stop and reflect on it when you say it, but we believe, we say together boldly, in the communion of the saints. Perhaps I need to point out that's not a biblical expression, but it is a very understandable expression having read the Bible. That is to say, we are part of a community of God's people that not that only stretches throughout the world, but stretches throughout history. And we are one with them. And so as we hear these great words from Hebrews, we learn as God's word to us that we need to be encouraged. We need to be encouraged as I am here. Sadly, many of you are not, but as I'm here in this fantastic church, this parish church that has served this community for centuries, we need to be encouraged by the way in which God's people have lived for him here in this market town, for the way in which they have been faithful to God through all the years. When we hear the history of churches, we often hear the story. It's very interesting how it's written. Often it's written about the clergy, those who have served here through the decades, through the centuries. And that's fine. And I'm not knocking the clergy, but perhaps, having been a clergyman for nearly 40 years, I have a right to say these things. I do think it's important that we don't focus only on the clergy. We thank God for those wonderful men and women of faith who've just lived for God here in Newbury. If you were here and we could do it together, what I'd love to happen, is if somebody would give the testimony of somebody who was really important here in this church in the war years. I'd love to hear about the way in which you learnt something of God through them, long since died. But I'd love to hear their story. And that's perhaps somebody could give a testimony of somebody who was here in the 60s and the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, the noughties, the tens. Do you know, I'd just love to hear those stories. Thank God for the clergy, but for the moment, leave them to one side. The ordinary men and women of God, the men and women of faith who've lived for God. We need to hear those stories. On this day, I encourage you to think about those who you know, those who've been important in your life. I'd love to tell you about the people who have been important to me. The saints, they're no longer with us, but people who had a foundational impact on my Christian life as I was growing up. You definitely hear about Richard and Sandy and Tim. All three, as it happens, disabled people. All three, as it happens, incredibly articulate in their faith. And the way in which they encouraged me, inspired me, told me about the nature of God, opened my eyes to what it meant to be a servant of God. I thank God for them. Thank God for Peter, my first church secretary, wonderful man of God, died horribly of cancer. But I think of the wonderful, wonderful example of faithfulness, carefulness he left for me. I think of my parents, who've died in recent years. Great people of prayer, great people of prayer, would faithfully and in detail be praying for my ministry every day, and those with whom I worked. That's just my story. But you've got your story. You've seen God at work. God has blessed you. And on this All Saints Day, we have this wonderful opportunity to celebrate these people who have gone before. Read history. Read the biographies and autobiographies of those who have gone before, those who've set an example of faith. We can be nourished by these people. And read Scripture. Scripture is there to encourage us. And in chapter 11 of Hebrews, we have this great gallery of saints, of those who lived and worked for God. The expression cloud of witnesses is not one that we find elsewhere, but it's wonderful, isn't it? We're just surrounded by these folk as if they're cheering us on as we go on this journey. We can hear their testimonies resonating with our experiences. So that's the first point. Be encouraged. These are all commands. Be encouraged. Secondly, be disciplined. Since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, says the writer, he doesn't say, since we're surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses, please sit down and feel great about things. No, no, no. Since we're surrounded by them, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. That is to say, these people have set an example of faith. They've set the bar high. And we now know we've got work to do. And supremely, we need to get rid of those things which prevent us from being the people of God, those things that distract us from being 100% for God. Sin This powerful expression, sin that so easily entangles. All of you will know what that means for you. Whether it's just a drop of selfishness, whether it's that bit of envy that's crept in and found room, whether that's not a lying word, but it wasn't exactly the truth. Do you know, just a little bit of sin that creeps in so easily entangles us. And he says, just throw it off. Get rid of it. Because we've got this cloud of witnesses, because we've got this amazing example of those who've gone before, let's make sure that we get rid of those things that prevent us from living fully for God. Be disciplined. Be disciplined. It will require work. I've had the privilege of knowing some great sportsmen and women over the years. And I thank God for the experience of knowing them. And you probably need to know, almost none of it has rubbed off. Curious, but there you go. I was brought up in Essex, near the Lloyd family. And they were very, very close friends of ours. And we often would meet with them. John Lloyd, for those of you who are very young, haven't a clue what I'm talking about. John Lloyd was our British number one tennis player in the late 80s and late 70s and early 80s. And the family is very significant. David Lloyd, of course, famous for the clubs, not such a good player as John Lloyd, but he was a Davis Cup player. And Tony Lloyd, a very strong Christian, great doubles player. So I knew the family and I knew how they worked. They were incredibly disciplined. I mean, life was tennis. That's how the equation worked. Everything, they just gave 100% to it. Everything was disciplined with a view to becoming better and better sportsmen. Totally focused on tennis. It's a principle of life, isn't it? That you achieve almost nothing in any part of life without a degree of discipline. Certainly so in sport. But we could talk about writing, we could talk about any form of art, we could talk about business, whatever. If you're going to really succeed, you've got to be disciplined. Well, folks, when we talk about living for God, we're talking about the most important thing you can do in life. So don't be surprised that the Word of God is saying to us, not just be encouraged, but be disciplined. Look at your life. Look at your life today. And look at the ways in which you could tune in that discipline to be a bit more fully focused on God. I seem to have had the opportunity many times in talking with you here to encourage you to get deeper in the Word of God. I do that. This is a church where there's a strong tradition of respect and love for the Word of God. It's great. But I encourage you personally to dig deeper in the Word of God, to get to know it better. I'm going to say it again. I think I've said it every time I preached here for quite a while, to encourage you to go through the Bible. I use the Bible in 1 Year app. Nikki Gumbel, HGB, really helpful. Just gives to me scripture, Old Testament, New Testament, every day, the encouragement to reflect upon it carefully. Let the Word of God seep into your lives, soak into your way of life. Get closer to the Word of God. It's not about quantity. It's not about quantity of reading the Bible, reading masses and masses of it. It's about listening carefully to what God is seeking to say to you. Be disciplined in prayer without becoming religious. Do you know what I'm saying? God doesn't want us to be people who just say the right words at the right time. He wants a relationship with us. So let's look for ways in which we can nurture that continual conversation with God in prayer. Be disciplined in study. Some of you are scholars. Some of you know the Word of God well. You've studied the Word of God already. I'd encourage you not to be lazy and to say, well, I've got the qualifications, that's that done. Not that. We need to continually be digging in the Word of God. Let its riches come out more and more. And I'm talking about study not as academic study, actually. I'm talking about study as allowing the Word to go deep, spending good time with it, reflective time with it, so that it becomes more fully a part of you. be disciplined in your support of the fellowship, the church. This has become much more difficult, hasn't it? Much more difficult as we have been separated from the fellowship that we love so much, separated from the singing that we love so much, separated from drinking coffee together, just being together, and all those things which are so crucial to fellowship. I'd say this to you, look carefully at the way in which you're supporting St. Nick's, supporting the fellowship, supporting other Christians you know. We need one another. And yes, it has become much more difficult, no question about it. But do you know, the phone is still there. We can still ring one another. We can still send emails. Even when we can't meet together, there's much we can do. So you've had two commands. You've got two more to go. Firstly, be encouraged. Secondly, be disciplined. Thirdly, persevere. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Hang in there, is what he's saying. Hang in there. It's not always going to be easy to live for God. It's just not. And so we need to hear the stories from Hebrews chapter 11, the examples of men and women of faith, of the way in which they hung in there. Look at people like Noah, bless, constructing his ark when it didn't look remotely necessary or relevant, but he hung in there. He was obedient to God. He did what God had commanded him to do. Think of Abraham. Abraham, who headed off on this journey of faith, as we famously know, not knowing where he was going. So much of that journey was very curious, very surprising, but he hung in there in faith. He hung in there with God. Think of Joseph. Wow, what a story, Joseph. So many twists and turns in the way, so many times when the light seemed to go out, when it was so terrible, but he hung in there. He persevered. He was faithful through all the twists and turns of the way. Think of Moses. What an extraordinary story. Think of the twists and turns of his life. Brought up in a palace. Goes out and murders somebody. Called by God as a shepherd to lead his people. And then the twists and turns of the way of God's people as they went through the wilderness. But they all hung in there. Friends, we need to hear that word, don't we? These are difficult times. I'm denying nothing. I spend a lot of my time supporting other churches and supporting clergy. I'm having constant conversation with church leaders. That's really sums up a large part of my life. And people are exhausted. They're tired. It's been a very, very difficult few months. And the kind of issues that we're struggling with at the moment are unfamiliar issues. Never been this way before. We can't say, well, we last had COVID-17, this is what we can't do that. It's all new. It's a huge challenge. I just say to you today, hang in there, persevere. It is difficult, but let's persevere in supporting one another and strengthening one another. I have my own voices that I've heard through the years from men and women of faith. People like William Carey, as a Baptist, I would mention William Carey, wouldn't I? But William Carey was the founder of the modern missionary movement for all denominations. On the 11th of March, 1812, there was a great fire that morning. 11th of March, 1812, a great fire in his printing works in Serampore. So William Carey started his work in the way that all missionaries did at the time, by translating the scriptures. Now, if you're going to translate the scriptures and make them accessible to other people of other tongues, then actually the first task you need to do is to write a dictionary, because they didn't exist. So that was his great work, and he had been working for 12 years on this work. 12 years writing these dictionaries, writing the scriptures in a number of languages. Quite phenomenal outcome in those years. And about 6 o'clock in the morning on the 11th of March 1812, there was a great fire. It all went up in smoke. Incredible. What did William Carey do? What would you do? Get on the next boat back to England, surely. Any sensible person would. No, he set to work. He set to work immediately. And after a year, amazingly, he got back to where he was at the time of the fire and actually said, movingly, it was so much easier to write these things the second time. But he persevered. When on the face of it, just imagine losing all that, those 12 years of work. Why did the Lord let it happen? All the rest of it. But he set to work. He persevered. I think of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. I use the name Dietrich Bonhoeffer because it was in my mid-teens that I first read the story of his life, and I was so moved by it. I feel I've almost walked with Dietrich Bonhoeffer through these years. You'll probably know the story, a German pastor who refused to accept the reordering of the German church, which Hitler brought in. Let's be clear, the majority of the church, the overwhelming majority of the church, went with Hitler's reordering. That's what happened. The confessing church was relatively small, which Bonhoeffer was involved in. He got involved because of his faith in Christ and his determination to be faithful to Christ. He got involved in an assassination attempt on Hitler's life in 1944, which failed. Finally, as you may know, he was executed just before the Americans got to that part of Germany, in Flossenbürg. I thank God for his perseverance. Wow, was that difficult. That's why the majority of Christians sided with Hitler, for their convenience, for their self-preservation, but he didn't. He persevered. Think of Mother Teresa. It's very easy to tell the stories of Mother Teresa these days. It all looks so simple and straightforward. She battled at every stage because it was not obvious to people in India that you should care for the dying because they're on the way out. They don't need caring for. But she saw Christ in them. She persevered. She cared and inspired many others to care too. Friends, God's calling to you today. It is a command, but it's a gentle, loving command, is to persevere, to hang in there. Let's keep faithful. A final word, called to be encouraged, called to be disciplined, called to persevere. Finally, we're called to focus. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus. The supreme illustration of faith, the supreme illustration of somebody who was 100% focused on God's way is Jesus. Jesus went to the cross for us. Let's hear what it says again. Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. It's good to look to those who've gone before. We thank God for All Saints Day and for all that it means to us. But the saints that we have known and the saints to whom I've referred have not been perfect. They've been wonderful and they've been inspiring, but they've not been perfect. Jesus is perfect. And so we are called by the word of God to fix our eyes on Jesus. Consider him. Focus your eyes on him. May God bless you as we walk through these very strange, very challenging days. May God give you his strength and daily encouragement. But above all else, I encourage you to keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. I'd love to pray with you. Loving Father, we thank you that your word is faithful. We thank you that it's always encouraging. We thank you for the way in which, out of your love for us, you challenge us to live for you. And so, Lord, we give to you all our emotions, all our concerns in this moment. and pray that you will help us as individuals and as a church to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. Thank you for All Saints Day. Thank you for the happy memory of those who have gone before. Lord, thank you for our calling to be your saints today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy rock and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his altar draw near. Join in profound adoration.
Magnificent, marvelous, matchless love, too vast and astounding to tell. Forever existing in worlds above, now offered and given to all. Oh, oh, fountain of beauty eternal, the Father, the Spirit, the Son, sufficient and endlessly generous, magnificent, marvelous, matchless love.
Marvelous, matchless love. Hey, how sure his love is. with a grateful heart give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks.